Hi, my name is Sindhil Kumar Thyagarajan. I'm from Tamil Nadu. I'm a professor working in Excel College of Physiotherapy as Haryana Chartered Physiotherapy Association is conducting e-PhysioCon 2020. For that call for expert lecturers area, I'm submitting this webinar. For your consideration, this webinar will be useful for the audience also. Thanks for giving these opportunities. Really, it's a best move whenever we are in a lockdown period. During this knowledge sharing from home to home, student to lecturer through expert platform, this is make tremendous knowledge to the peoples and as well as like me, like that association. Now I am going to share my screen, going to present my topic for the viewers. Right. In this presentations, I am going to discuss about sciatica. Almost you hopefully know about the word of low back pain. Every person in the world, almost some data is telling 80% of people living in world is suffering from back pain at least one time in their life. So everybody get to know about back pain experience. So now I am going to talk about one topic called name called pseudo sciatica. Hopefully you know about pseudo, which mean to say fake or false sciatica. Everybody know about this term sciatica. The expert physios and students third year or fourth year people are know about the sciatica word. The pain is running down from the lower back and buttock and running down to posterior or back of the thigh to the calf muscles and sole down, which is called it a sciatica. So running down pain from back to sole. What is fake sciatica or pseudo sciatica? Why it's called as fake sciatica or pseudo sciatica? Now we are going to discuss about it. So in this area, we are in this webinar, we are going to discuss about the contents which relate to prevalence about sciatica, fake sciatica. What we know it about sciatica so far, what we know through my presentation, we are going to learn about it. And other names for sciatica also we are going to discuss. Difference from sciatica and pseudo sciatica, we are going to discuss about it. Difference between sciatica and pseudo sciatica. Clinical presentations, how this fake sciatica different from the sciatica. And what is the clinical significance, we are going to know about this sciatica. And treatment techniques, how to treat this kind of patients. Clinical expertise, my personal experience I'm going to share for you as I am a dry needling practitioner, as I am back pain practitioner. I am going to share my knowledge which is gathered from the patients. Every patient is a teacher to me, so every patient taught to me a lot. So that knowledge I am going to share to you. That is why I put your word clinical expertise and clinical implications. Through that expertise, what I implemented in my practice, I am going to share to you also. Right? Prevalence, as it is incidence, as you know very well. Low back pain is a common condition with lifetime prevalence affecting 84% of population in the world. As per the data, 700 million people surviving in the world, all over this globe. So among these people, 84% of people suffering from the back pain. Among 37 peoples are suffering chronic low back pain. The 84% of people, one episodes they come onto, but all other from among them, 37% of peoples are suffering very frequently, more than 6 months suffering from 37% of people with chronic low back pain. Among this, radicular pain is affects radicular leg pain is affects seriously to the 20 to 25% of people very seriously. That 25 to 27 people percentage of people are suffering very badly. Whenever I am receiving the patients, they used to say chronically means not only 1 year or 2 years, more than 10 years I have suffering from this problem. I have this problem more than 20 years and I am surviving this problem these many years with this back pain is disturbing me a lot. It won't allow me to do my day-to-day activities like this. A lot of complaints they will say. So for that only I came with this topic. Anatomy about sciatic nerve, the basic about sciatic nerve is one of the thickest and longest nerve in the human body. Sciatic nerve is the chief nerve from the posterior compartment of thigh. It's a branch of nerve from sacral plexus, root values L4 to S3. A lumbar plexus and also sacral plexus sharing this nerve. We have a two component, tibial component as well as common peroneal nerve component. So below the piriformis, from the descent down, how it's coming down, it starts from there and coming down. You can able to observe here, it's coming down below the piriformis muscles. This is a serious, the pathway is making us to go this kind of problems, sciatica like this problem. This pathway is making issues. So below piriformis from this and down under the cover of gluteus maximus. So over this area we can have a gluteus maximus muscles. These muscles, two muscles, very importantly, sometimes 7.1% of people's the muscles will be like this. The muscle pierces. The sciatic nerve pierces through the muscles going down. When we had a hypertrophy in the piriformis muscles, when we have a spasm in the muscle, or when we are sitting prolonged manner or Valet syndrome like that, if you are keeping a valet in the pocket, the piriformis muscles getting compressed. So when it get compressed, automatically the nerves start to entrap. This is a one of entrapment neuropathy. So pseudo sciatica is a one of the entrapment neuropathy. The pathway got disturbed or pathway got space occupying lesion, hopefully you know about it, space occupied. So automatically when the space, sciatic nerve spaces get occupied, automatically start to compress when the patients start to feel the symptoms mimic like sciatica, but it's not a sciatica. So that is main concept of my presentations. You come to know the slides close. What is fake sciatica? So now I am going to discriminate this two pain into two different non-discogenic sciatica, discogenic sciatica. Discogenic sciatica due to disc prolapse, patient is getting a sciatic nerve symptoms like we call it as normally sciatica, neurogenic sciatica. Then other one is a musculogenic sciatica. For example, the patients don't have a issue of disc prolapse, but due to posture or some other issues, the patient is getting a non-discogenic entrapment of sciatica in the level of subgluteal region. The nerve is passing between the greater trochanter and the ischial tuberosity, that the space of lesion or entrapment will take place and start to compress the sciatic nerve. Then the patient start to get a sciatic nerve symptoms the patient is getting, that's why it's called as fake sciatica. Sciatic nerve entrapment at the other level of ischial tuberosity, very commonly getting a ischial tuberosity level, then the compression will take place. Patients often reporting the pain in the gluteal buttock region, the back of the lower back and buttock area, and as well as patients feel shooting like a pain, burning pain sometimes, the achy like always, back of the leg, we feel it out. It's mimic like sciatica, but it won't be a sciatic, neurogenic sciatica. It's a musculogenic sciatica. Okay, what is the pathomechanics behind it? Structures that can be involved not only from piriformis and also fibrous band containing blood vessels, gluteal muscles like gluteus maximus, medius, hamstring, gemelli, and obturator internus. With this all together, occupy the space and the patients start to get the sciatic nerve symptoms. That is why it's named as deep gluteal syndrome. It's otherwise called it as deep gluteal syndrome. Pseudosciatica, also other one name. Other ones, a few more names also there, I'll share you. Space occupying lesion not only take place by piriformis muscle only, the fibrous band nearby, the blood vessels nearby, gluteal muscles nearby, hamstring, all together is occupy the space and the nerve got entrapped and the patient start to feel the sciatic nerve symptoms. Epidemiology of, before we discussed about general low back pain epidemiology, now we are going to discuss about the piriformis syndrome epidemiology. Piriformis syndrome may responsible for 0.3% to 6% of all cases in the low back pain. 6% of people not from the discogenic sciatica, they are from osteogenic sciatica. With an estimated amount of new cases of low back pain every year and sciatica at 40 million annually, they are suffering from back pain. Incidence of piriformis syndrome would be roughly 2.4 million per year all around the world. Middle-aged persons are very commonly suffer from piriformis syndrome, or otherwise the people will say about piriformis syndrome, pseudosciatica, deep gluteal nerve syndrome, all is same terminology only. So 1:6, which means to say the males are suffering 1% means a female is coming to 6% affect with this problem. So that means incidence is in female is quite high, right? Especially I was practiced in Bangalore also. I can able to treat this kind of people very easily when they come with this problem. I can able to diagnose very easily. The people usually they go with some expert people and come with this problem. So and so they will come with serious mental worries. I am going to survive this problem throughout the life. They usually ask these questions. When I tell to them the basic approaches how to treat this pain, when I teach to them, automatically they can understand very better way. They recover pain within 1 hour, 1 or 2 weeks. They recover very fast. They feel very happy. I used to teach them how to manage with that pain. Whenever you are getting that pain, how to manage that pain, how to treat the pain by yourself. By education, the patients is make them to recover very fast way. That is my concept of teaching this slides to you. Causes: trauma to the hip or buttock area, piriformis muscle hypertrophy. The people, those who are from the field of athletes during the periods of increased weight lifting, requirements of pre-screen season conditioning that time, and all the piriformis hypertrophy also. When the piriformis become hypertrophy, automatically the muscles get entrapped, the space get occupied, so this the sciatic nerve cannot able to pass very easily that space. The patient start to feel the symptoms. Sitting for prolonged periods, my concept of teaching to you, these peoples are vulnerable peoples, getting this low back pain very often nowadays and all. Taxi drivers, hopefully you know about the cities, the peoples are those who are working in the cities, two main social sharing taxi is available. Those peoples are very often complaining this problem. Office workers sitting prolonged time, like clerical workers, people's bicycle riders also suffering with this problem very seriously. So because of keep on sitting in a small seat like that, cycle stuff and all, the cycle also will be like this. So the sitting posture will be like this. Awkward postures and awkward sitting positions. But long period, prolonged sitting period, more than 8 hours, more than 10 hours. If you go to the government offices and all, they sit in a wooden chairs and all without even no cushion. They sit roughly over rough areas and all, this piriformis get compressed very fast, and that leads to sciatic nerve get occupied in that localized area, and the patient start to get the symptoms, right? So causes, we should know why that cause is creating this issue. If you treat the cause, automatically you can able to recover the patients almost 60% from the problem, right? Okay, clinical presentations. What is the clinical presentations will be there about this? Clinical presentation. The patients usually suffer with chronic pain in the buttock and hip area, and the patients usually complains tenderness in the gluteal region, tenderness in the retrogluteal region, the back of the glute muscles area. And pain will be unilateral. The discogenic sciatica, usually the patients, 10% of people will be suffer with the bilateral involvement will be there. Here we can able to, the presentation will be there only one side, right side or left side. Intolerance of sitting more than 20 to 30 minutes. The person cannot able to sit more than half an hour, right? The pain during night time and getting better during daytime, right? This is a classical symptoms will be there. Sciatica and all, the presentation will be different whenever sitting quite long period. Usually disc prolapse induced back pain. The patient usually complains sitting, I feel more pain. But here, when the patient is mobile, when the patient is active in the day-to-day life, the patients get recovered from the pain. This is a classical difference between the urogenic sciatica, musculogenic, musculogenic sciatica. The when pain when getting out from the bed, getting up from the, when we are pushing out from the bed, the patients need to give pressure on the buttock. So that pressure start to again space occupy, then the patient get a pain back in the sciatica. Pain in the buttock that is worsened by kyphomas. When you do internal rotation, external rotation, as you know, the piriformis is one of the classical external rotator. When you do the internal rotation or external rotation, those kind of movements, the patients get some kind of pain will be there. How to differentiate from discogenic sciatica? This is very important. Try to listen carefully. Diagnosis of trigger point. We can able to easily find the trigger point over the piriformis area. Discogenic pain, usually patients will complain the lower back pain. The pain will be travel from the lower back to coming over there. But when the piriformis pseudo sciatica, piriformis syndrome like that pain and all, the patients usually complain pain in the lower buttock area. We can, they classically complain the buttock area is very painful. I feel burning pain sensation. Whenever I sit, I feel like ache, discomforting me, dull aching pain always will be there. It's making me to discomfort badly. So we can able to discriminate from the urogenic sciatica. On palpation, when we palpate the gluteal regions, we can able to feel the third grade tenderness, sometimes even fourth degree of tenderness, we can able to, when we palpate on the gluteal area, we can able to feel the tenderness, third and fourth degree tenderness. Even sometimes the patients never allowed to touch. Pain will not be aggravated while coughing and sneezing and functional activities. This is very classical presentation in the sciatica. When we are coughing and sneezing, if you have a disc prolapse, intradiscal pressure will increase and start to compress the sciatic nerve, sciatic plexus. Automatically, the patients feel a radiating pain, so provocating pain like that. But in piriformis syndrome, pseudo sciatica, when the patients are sneezing, when the patients are coughing, the patients won't feel the pain radiating down. Whenever they sit longer period, they get a pain, right? The people, those who are sitting with the cross legs, the people are using the purse or wallets in the packets, they suffer. I know a lot of patients, I used to advise them to don't keep your packets, don't keep your wallet in the packet, back packet, keep it in the front packet, the symptoms will be recovered almost 60%. I know a lot of patients like that. So we need to educate the patients in a better way. Patients will recover from the conditions very faster. Gluteal muscles, passive stretches. When you do stretches, ask the patient to lie down supine, you keep the legs in a cross and just push the knee like a adduction internal rotation, automatically the patients feel more pain. If classical kind of this kind of presentation will be there, we can able to declare discogenic, it's not pure discogenic sciatica. Tell to the patients to do piriformis stretches, piriformis lengthening procedures. Automatically the patients recover from the pain very easily. So as I said, the few number of people from back pain when you are receiving from in your clinic, few number of people, so I think 0.5% of people's piriformis syndrome induced pain will be there. So when you correct the piriformis length, automatically the patients will recover very fast. I can damn sure I can able to say this because of this my experience. That is why I come out with this slide to you, right? Specialist, how to differentiate the symptoms also will tell to you. Now we have two tests I'm sharing to you. One test, we have some sensitivity specificity analysis there. With that test we can able to differentiate from discogenic sciatica, right? We have a first test name called FAR test. FAR, which means to say expand, flexion, adduction, internal rotation test. And one more test is there, I'll share with you next slide. The FAR test, the patients should lie down in a supine position. The leg, you can able to observe the picture, you can able to observe the picture very keenly. The above picture, the picture when you are asked the patient to lie down, the above leg, top of the leg, you can able to hold like this in a flexion, adduction, internal rotation. When you do like this, patients will complain. The reproduction of buttock pain will be there. That indicates patient is suffering from piriformis induced sciatica. That means pseudo sciatica. It's a musculogenic sciatica. It's not a neurogenic sciatica, right? So the sensitivity of test is 88%, specificity 83%, right? We can use this test for clinical practice purpose. Very very helpful. I used to do this test to discriminate from the person from neurogenic sciatica, right? Another one more test which is called it as Freiberg sign. We make the patient to lie down in a supine position. We ask the patient to forcibly, we have to do internally rotate and extend the thigh and followed by affect the leg in an attempt to stretch the piriformis. So when you do like this, patients again same like this is also provocating test. The patients again start to feel the pain is going from the butt to posterior thigh, it's going down to leg and the going down to sole like that. The patients, they feel again when you do this maneuver, the patients feel running down pain. This is a provocating test. These two tests will be clinically helpful to differentiate from the discogenic sciatica. Right, this FAR test is one of the classical tests to discriminate from discogenic sciatica. Deficient diagnosis, what are things which mimics, right? Hamstring injury, right? First of all, the second one is lumbosacral disc injuries, right? As it is, I am using the word discogenic sciatica, right? Lumbosacral discogenic pain syndrome, Paisley syndrome, radiculopathy, spine, spondylolisthesis, spondylolysis, sacroiliac joint injury or dysfunction, inferior gluteal artery aneurysm or pseudoaneurysm, any malignancy. As it is, I told you, space occupying lesion, we should differentiate from the malignancy or space occupying lesions, or we should be differentiated. Arteriovenous AV malformation, these are the things we should discriminate. Not all the sciatica is not a pseudo sciatica. We should differentiate diagnosis. That is why I shared two things: the clinical presentation and as well as two tests, Freiberg sign and as well as FAR test. This will presentation and causes and all will tell to you clearly. We have to ask the patients case history, how long they are suffering from this problem, where the pain is coming from, how they sit in the office, what is the nature of job, how long they do their work, so how they sit when the days, when the time process goes, how they sit. We have to expand all the questions to the patients. We have to get back the answer. From that, we can able to easily differentiate from discogenic sciatica, right? Not all the MRI scan will say about discogenic sciatica. Clinical expertise notes, this is my main area to target. Trigger point in the gluteus minimus, referred pain similar like sciatica, but this is named, this pseudo sciatica is named by Janet Travel. Hopefully you know about it. It's this person's named, Janet Travel named president, Kennedy physician was named this pseudo sciatica word. Pseudo means false, right? So these trigger points form from numerous reasons, from direct trauma, internal muscular injections, postural distortion, running, swimming, walking too far and too fast over uneven terrains, and sport in activities such as handball, tennis ball, cycling. All these causes may chance to cause a trigger point in the three areas. For example, corridus lumborum, gluteus medius, gluteus maximus, piriformis. These four muscles are also the another one of the culprits which is causing the sciatic like pain in the back pain patients, right? So we have to treat these trigger points. The patients will recover very fast from the discogenic pain, right? We have stretches, we have lengthening procedures, we have muscular techniques, right? Myofascial techniques. So with that, we can use the techniques, we can able to recover the patients very fast from pseudo sciatica, right? So when the patients have a gluteus medius, hopefully you know about trigger point. Trigger point is a taut band. So taut band, how it's getting, so these many causes as I shared you. So gluteus medius, when trigger points will be there, the patients feel like pseudo sciatica, back pain, difficulty in supine lying. As I told you, these symptoms mimic with pseudo sciatica, difficulty in sitting, right? As it is, sciatica patients also will complain, pseudo sciatica patients also will complain, sitting is difficult. Same like gluteus, when you have a trigger point, the gluteus medius patient will complain difficulty in sitting. Gluteus maximus trigger points patients again same like it's a nerve entrapment, buttock pain, iliosacral pain, lateral thigh pain, hip pain, sciatic also. So when we have a gluteus maximus patients, trigger points will be there, patients feel like this kind of symptoms. Piriformis syndrome. Piriformis, when the patients have a piriformis trigger point, same like buttock pain, importance due to nerve entrapment. This is one of the physiotherapists should be know about it. Lateral thigh and hip pain, pain in the intercourse, sciatic stress, incontinence, anal, genital, perineal pain, posterior thigh pain, and all will be there, right? So we have to treat the trigger points of gluteus medius, maximus, piriformis, and one more muscle. We call it as corridus lumbar, right? Corridus lumbar, when the patients have a corridus lumborum trigger point, same like the patients will complaining blotting, nausea, abdominal cramps, buttock pain, iliosacral pain, lateral thigh and hip pain, low back pain. So we have to treat these trigger points. Patients also will come out from pseudo sciatica very better way, right? Clinical implications, how to treat this trigger points, we have a lot of way. As we are developing, we are grown up nice way, our field is grown up nice way, we have a number of techniques. So here some few techniques I mentioned, more than that techniques also available. I named some techniques which I know, which I practice in my clinical. So trigger release done for the muscles corridus lumborum, gluteus medius, gluteus minimus, and piriformis, and gluteus maximus. Active trigger point release will be done by use of roller or tennis ball by use of that, we can able to advise the patient to release these trigger points in these muscles. Trigger point dry needling is one of the best way to treat this all muscles, because of quadratus lumborum is one of the deep muscles, and piriformis, gluteus maximus is a very broad muscles. We want to treat the trigger points. It's quite difficult to treat by use of by your hands. So that's why deep situated structures we can able to treat better way by use of DNT, dry needling therapy. We can able to treat better way. And we hit the bullseye, trigger point area, automatically the patient will recover very fast. I know a lot of patients. I am treating in my clinic by use of trigger points. When these four muscles, automatically the patient's low back pain, when the patient comes with pseudosciatica or sciatica, I can able to differentiate very better way. As I told you, the previous manners, so I can able to treat them better way. Passive stretches, start with the passive stretches, then we come out with the slowly. We have active stretches. We as advise the patient to treat by themselves. And also we teach some core exercises, back exercises, hamstring stretches and all, and line stretches. Like that exercise, we can use it and able to treat them better, right? Yeah, here I am sharing some postures for you. Quadratus lumborum, how to do stretches by use of this position. We can able to easily stretch the muscles, will be over here. We can able to stretch very better way. And if the patients feel discomfort in this position, we can able to advise the patient to go for this supine-lying position stretch, right? Gluteus maximus stretch. In sitting and as well as lying positions, we can able to easily treat the sciatica. We advise the patient these stretches also. I advise the patient to do the stretches every 4 hours once, at least per day, 3 times. One session is containing at least one sitting is containing 5 times of stretch. 10 times of holding is needed compulsory. 10 holding, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. When they are stretch position, should be hold it out and advise the patient to do at least 5 times every 4 hours once. If they are in a work situations and all, advise the patient to do during the work period also, during the working situations also. This and all. Will we do it in a chair position itself? The patients feel comfortable, they can do it in even office also. Tears, do's, avoid prolonged sitting. Advise the patients when those who are sitting in a prolonged period, computer professionals advise the patient to get up from the chair every 1 hour once, every 45 minutes. Advise the patient to walk here and there, at least ask the patient to go to washroom or advise the patient to go to drink a water and come back to sit every 1 hour once, as the patient to relax their positions. Stretches 2 to 3 times, but as I told you, educate the patients annual basis. Patient should be told about the importance of maintaining compliance if they want to pass the outcome. So if they do stretch, the patients feel better. Why can't advise the patient to do the stretches every 4 hours once, right? Instead of surviving the pain, do stretches. The patients feel free. Advise the patient to do stretches regularly every 4 hours once. Recurrent pain can be prevented by doing regular stretches, right? 5 to 10 minutes of stretches per day, morning, at least evening, 2 times, the patients will recover from this issue throughout the life, better way, right? Make frequent stops when driving to stand and stretches whenever the patients are going long travel. Advise the patients every 1 hour once, get up from the car position, and ask the patient to walk around the car 1 time and go back to sit and try. Okay. This kind of modifications, when you advise ergonomical modifications, patients feel much better, right? My clinical implication is advise the patients active therapy, right? Exercises, stretches, back exercises, stretches. As I told you, gluteus maximus stretches, quadratus lumborum stretches, and piriformis stretches make them to feel much better. Why can't we advise the patient to do active therapy instead of advise the patient to come to my clinic, get this my TNT every 1 month once? It's not needed. Advise the patient to do regular stretches, because of active therapy is support research is supporting concludes significant changes in muscular performance were observed when we are advising active therapy patients feel much better. Active therapy empowers all clients to achieve an accelerated recovery and also is reduce the risk of symptoms recurrence, right? Why can't we advise the patient to active stretches? That is comes in the category of active therapy, right? Conclusion, I'm going to finish my slide. So my concept is not all radiating pain won't be a disc pathology. So we have to differentiate discogenic sciatica and musculogenic sciatica. If the patient is musculogenic sciatica, try to concentrate more on stretching, release the muscles, trigger point will be the release your trigger point by use of self release or by use of by active releases, the patients feel much better, right? As you are the movement expert, if you miss the diagnosis, it may end up with the serious medical worries to the patients. The patients start to think something about disc prolapse, disc problem. I'm going to survive with this pain throughout the life. My friend is suffering very badly. I'm also going to suffer very badly. My wife is going to scold me. I cannot able to go or play with my baby. The patients will start to think lot of worries. So we stop those worries if you diagnose better way, right? Muscle involvements could cause radiation pain, example, referred pain, using your trigger points. So treat the cause, not the symptoms always. So advise the patient, if you're sitting long time, advise the patient to get up from the chair every 1 hour. If you are driving, taxi driver, advise the patient to get up from the chair, get up from the seat, car seat every 1 hour once. If they are traveling quite longer period, get from the passengers or get the permission, get down from the car and take the rest, take the walk around the car, the patients feel much better. Those kind of things we advise the patients, patients will ready to do it out, right? Medication never helps to reduce the pain. Your stretches, your exercises, your active releases, your trigger point release, your DMT will help them instead of advise the patient to go for medicine. Right, patients' clinical education and make them to understand the importance of exercise leave him or her to achieve permanent recovery. That is my concept, entire juice of my presentations. Right, so advice. So whenever we are receiving the sciatic kind of patients, differentiate by doing the specialties and all, we can able to easily treat them much better. Right, thank you. So now I am going to stop my presentation. Thanks for giving this opportunity to present my fixed sciatica, pseudo sciatica presentations. Thanks to the team, Haryana Chartered Association team. Once again, thank you.